Can't hear you.
जी,
प्लीज गो ऑन, गो
शी इज
ऑन.
वर्किंग एज एसोसिएट प्रोफेसर इन डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ ओबीजी केएमसी मणिपाल. शी हैज ऑल्सो वर्क एक्सपीरियंस ऑफ 10 years इन टीचिंग एज वेल एज इन क्लिनिकल फील्ड. शी इज एक्सपर्ट ऑफ असिस्टेड रिप्रोडक्टिव टेक्नोलॉजी एंड ऑल्सो शी इज वर्किंग इन ART सेंटर मणिपाल. She has a total of 20 publications and around 26 conference presentations. She has also conducted workshop for PhD students for better publication in 2019. I welcome you, ma'am. We are glad to have you here. Handing over the session to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Chaitra. At the outset, I would like to thank Dr. Ajit for inviting me on the occasion of this PCO month and a CME on that. It's my pleasure to be talking to all of you. I hope I'm audible.
Ajit? Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am, you're audible. Yeah.
Yeah. So, I'll be briefing about PCOS and what maybe you need to know regarding PCOS and how it's going to be affecting women's life. This month is PCOS awareness month. So all over the world, they are creating awareness on PCOS. I think it is very important.
Ma'am, before that, I'll request all the participants to keep off their mics and videos, please.
Yeah,
ma'am, please go ahead. Who is this? I'll just keep off the mics myself. Yeah, ma'am, please talk. No problem. Yeah. You can start. Yeah.
Yeah. So this is a PCOS awareness month. So it is very, I think it is very important to create awareness among youngsters, also among the reproductive age group women to know about this PCOS. I think Chaitra, Ajit are doing great job in, conducting this kind of workshop, especially targeting girls, young girls, and women, young women or youth, I can say, wherein you can actually help them know what PCOS is and also and handle the situation better and also prevent many problems which can occur because of PCOS. The slides are seen, right?
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
PCOS is and its impact on women's life. Okay, so I'm going to talk on this. And so basically, what is PCOS? So all of us need to know what is this PCOS and how much we need to worry about this PCOS. Okay, so it is it's a genetic syndrome and it is a hormone related problem. It's going to affect the metabolic system in the body and also the reproductive system. And it affects about one, what is the global burden of this disease? Like how much it is affecting world over. You know that the lifestyle is changed all over the world, the way we work. And because of this, there is increasing incidence of PCOS among the youth. So even, so there are more women or more girls coming with the problems related to PCOS. So there are certain things that we need to know or we need to worry about at times about this PCOS. Not that everything, everybody, who has been diagnosed PCOS, are they really PCOS? Even that we need to know. So it affects about 1 in 10. Okay, so if you say, 10 women out of them, one will be having polycystic ovaries, okay, or polycystic ovarian syndrome. So that means to say it's so common that we really need to think about this problem. And I think it's a global problem among the women in the reproductive age group. So what is PCOS? It's a serious genetic hormone, metabolic and reproductive disorder that affects women and girls. So there is genetic problem in this, which is a base for it, that why this particular girl or this particular woman has developed PCOS is genetically inbuilt. There are also interlinked hormonal problems, which in turn leads to metabolic problems in the body. Metabolic in the sense, there will be problems related to glucose metabolism, or it may be cholesterol or lipid metabolism. All these things will be linked. And in effect, it will also result in reproductive disorders. Okay. And it is a leading cause of female infertility. So long run, like as the age advances, there will be problems in conceiving for these women who are suffering with PCOS. And it's a precursor of serious conditions including obesity, type 2 diabetes, cardiovascular diseases, and even endometrial cancer. So these are the long-term problems which are associated with PCOS. Now, as I told you, it's the burden is about, it affects 1 in 10 women, and about 10 to 15%, that is about 10 to 15% is the incidence all over. If you see 100 women, about 10 or 15 of them will be suffering with PCOS, and 50%, see that 50% of them are under or not diagnosed. That means many women will have this problem, but they are mostly not diagnosed. And 50% of the PCOS who develop also develop type 2 diabetes or even pre-diabetes before the age of 40. So there is early onset diabetes in these women who suffer with PCOS. I'm going to tell you why these things happen so that it becomes more clear for you and you'll be able to understand that this PCOS is what are the problems of this PCOS. And about 3.8 billion estimated annual cost of, this is for the Americans, they spend on this. So the healthcare system also will have to be adjusted accordingly, because women go to the hospital with various problems and in turn will be spending. So again, the cost increases, and it is three times there is increased risk for these women to develop endometrial cancer. Endometrium is nothing but the lining within the uterine cavity or the uterus or the womb, what we call, within that, which is normally shed every month. So there is increased risk. You can see three times increased risk for development of endometrial cancer for these women who suffer with PCOS. So how to know? So what are the problems? How do we actually know that particular woman is having this PCOS? So those are the symptoms. So what symptoms, with what symptoms they may present? So usually they'll have irregular periods or no periods at all. Many women, normally what we say, normal menstrual cycle should last anywhere between 28 days to 35 days. This is a normal range for a menstrual cycle to fall in. Anything that is less than 28 days or anything more than 35 days is what we call an abnormal menstrual cycle. So anybody who is usually in women with PCOS, they do not have periods regularly. So there is an infrequent cycles. They usually do not bleed monthly. So what happened to these women is they either bleed once in 2 or 3 months or 4 months, sometimes 6 months, sometimes even a year, they will not have menstruation. So that is a problem. Okay, so that needs to be tackled. They have to come to the hospital if they have these kind of problems. So many times we see girls not reporting in spite of them having period of amenorrhea, that is not having menstruation for a long time. So that is not at all good. The menstruation that occurs is good for the endometrium. Endometrium is what the lining is, that is what is shed every month. So that is always good that somebody has menstruation. If somebody doesn't have menstruation, that is not good for that particular woman. So when somebody doesn't have menstruation for long periods, say about 2-3 months, do not bleed, they have to report to the hospital. Then there is increased facial hair or body hair. Normally, there will be some amount of hair over the face, over the body. All Indians will have because we are genetically like that. But if this kind of hair turns into male-like pattern, okay? So if this hair is become thick, so that is what we call as hirsutism. So that is abnormal. If somebody starts developing excessive facial hair or body hair, or even chest. So when there is these kind of hair there which are thick, though that is abnormal. So they again need to report. And there is hair loss. So excessive hair otherwise, like on the face and the body, but on the head, they will have hair loss. Then overweight. This is a very common problem with PCOS. They generally put on weight. Okay. So, and they also experience a rapid increase in weight. So there is a sudden increase in weight. They'll say last month I was say about 60 kg, suddenly I become 65. So it is just rapidly increasing and have difficulty in losing weight. They have oily skin and also the egg, there is increased development of acne. Okay, so pimples, what we commonly call, is more in these women. I'm going to tell you why this happens so you will understand better, and they also have difficulty in becoming pregnant. Now, what causes this PCOS? I told you that it is genetically inbuilt. Okay, so that is somebody has to develop PCOS will develop. So because they have genes for that, and that is why they are developing PCOS. So it is mainly, and it runs in families, like sister, mother also suffered with similar problem. Usually the daughter also may have. And it is mainly related to these two hormones. One is testosterone and the other one is the insulin. Okay. So what exactly happens in these women is there is a problem in the hypothalamo, pituitary and ovarian axis. So wherein there is a problem that is mainly because of there is some gene which is coding, and it is still not clear as to why that particular woman has developed PCOS. Why not somebody else? So yes, if there are siblings, elder sister may have, younger sister may not have. So why that particular person has developed, not yet it has been discovered or found as to why exactly this person is suffering with PCOS. Now, you need to understand these are the two hormones which are very important, causative for the symptoms of this PCOS. One is testosterone and the other one is the insulin. So, these women do not ovulate. So, normally, every menstruation occurs because there is ovulation taking place. So, these women who have PCOS do not ovulate. So, they have a problem. Normally, there are hormones which are secreted from the hypothalamus, pituitary and the ovary. So there is a dysregulation of this hormone system because of which these women do not ovulate. And also, not only that, they have increased testosterone in the ovary. Normally, all women will secrete some amount of testosterone. Testosterone is a male hormone. Estrogen is a female hormone. Now, testosterone is in a very low level in women. Okay, but in higher level in men. But in these women with PCOS, they have higher level of testosterone in their ovaries. Now, because of this testosterone, which are there, which is circulating in the blood, that will act on these hairs, hair follicles, and start these hair follicles change into male-like pattern. So that is the reason why they develop hirsutism. And also this testosterone will increase, that there is in the ovary, the testosterone levels will be high. So because of which it will stop ovulation. So these patients do not ovulate. Ovulation is nothing but a process of release of egg from the ovary. So normally this egg release should happen so that that is mainly because of pregnancy to happen. When pregnancy doesn't happen, then there will be menstruation. So these women, because of this increased testosterone in their ovary, their estrogen levels will also be changed and they do not ovulate. Okay, so that is a point one. So because they don't ovulate, they will not menstruate. So that is the reason why they do not have menstruation every month, unlike other normal women. They don't menstruate. So once in 2 or 3 months, they menstruate because endometrium keeps growing under the influence of estrogen. And at one point of time, it will no longer be able to get the blood supply, because of which they start bleeding. And that bleeding will be heavy. If at all a woman starts bleeding in PCOS, the bleeding will also be very heavy. Then the other hormone which I was talking about is insulin. So they have problem with this insulin, and they have insulin resistance. Their body, there are receptors for this insulin, will be resistant. Again, genetically mediated. So this insulin do not act on the receptors properly. So because of which, when insulin is not acting, the blood sugar level starts rising. Plus, this insulin also, the amount, so because it is not acting, there will be more secretion of insulin. And because there is more secretion of insulin, there is increased amount of insulin in the body, which again is a problem, because that insulin acts like insulin, like growth factor. It's a kind of growth factor, because of which they put on weight. So there is increased body weight in these patients, and they do not tend to, or it is very difficult for them to lose weight. So now it becomes a vicious circle. That is, once they start gaining weight, that also acts or adds on to the hormonal problem, because the fat content, there will be high estrogen level in their body. And again, it inhibits the hypothalamo pituitary ovarian axis, inhibits ovulation, and in turn, the problem increases. So that is the reason why these patients have irregular cycles. And this is the reason why they have hirsutism or excessive body hair. And this is the reason why they have increased body weight. So insulin is, and not only that, now insulin, whatever is there, is not able to act properly on the receptors. So because of which they have high amount of circulating glucose also, because glucose needs to be utilized with the help of insulin. So that is the reason why they tend to develop diabetes mellitus early than their other normal counterparts. As such, Indian women and men are having high risk for development of diabetes. As such, we are all prone for development of diabetes, but more so very early in PCOS. So that is a long-term problem of these patients with PCOS. Now, how we usually diagnose these PCOS? Now, everybody will start saying that I have PCOS. They come to us and then they say that I have PCOS. How they have been diagnosed as PCOS by ultrasound. So does this mean that they have PCOS? If somebody gives a report, you may have a report, or somebody has shown you a report of an ultrasound that is done, which says that there is PCOS. So is it really PCOS is what we have to think. An ultrasound telling they have PCO ovary, that is polycystic ovary. Normally, these women, when you do an ultrasound, the ovaries will be cystic. So cyst is nothing but fluid-filled structure. So if there are multiple fluid-filled structure, we call it as polycystic ovary. Now, if somebody has polycystic ovary, do we really need to worry? So this is what we have to understand. The answer is no. If somebody has PCO in the ultrasound only, you need not tell them, or you need not call them as PCOS. Even in normal women, may have PCO looking ovaries. So what is that is important for the diagnosis of PCOS, or how we say that yes, this woman is, or this girl is suffering from polycystic ovaries, is by this criteria. That is, if the any of the two, if it is present, which I'm going to tell now, only then we call as PCOS or polycystic ovarian syndrome. Okay, so that's a syndrome. So if there is irregular or infrequent or no periods, okay, so there is a menstrual abnormality, or an increase in facial or body hair or acne, and or if the blood tests are showing that high levels of testosterone in them or the testosterone metabolites in them, and if there is an ultrasound that shows polycystic ovaries, if any of the out of the three through two should be present. Suppose a woman only has polycystic ovaries in ultrasound, but not other two are not there, then we don't call them as polycystic ovarian syndrome. Okay, so any of these symptoms or the blood tests also. So what we usually say is if they have menstrual abnormality or if there is androgenic symptoms. Androgenic symptoms are either excessive facial hair or body hair and presence of acne. Okay, presence of pimples. Or if the blood test is showing that there is hyperandrogenism, only then we call them as PCOS. So out of these three, any two should be there. If even one is present, we don't diagnose as polycystic ovarian syndrome. We may call it as by ultrasound polycystic ovaries. So this is what is important and this is what needs to be understood. So you need not worry if you have just PCO looking ovary, unless you have any other symptoms. Okay, so if just it's looking PCO ovary, no need to worry as long as the menstruation is okay, no acne, no excessive weight gain, all these things are not there. So this is what a normal ovary looks like. So this is the uterus, this is the fallopian tube, and this is the normal ovary. And this is how a polycystic ovary looks like. So this is what we call as hirsutism. You can see excessive hair growth and this needs to be removed often. And this is male-like pattern. This thin hair is not hirsutism, thick hairs, and you can see acne. So this is not normal. Okay, so this is abnormal. So having understood how PCOS is presented and what is the reason for this PCOS, what we need to worry about, is there any long-term health problems? I told you there is menstruation problem, there is look-wise they are obese or on the fatter side, and there is infertility, conception is a problem because they don't ovulate properly. So if they don't ovulate, there is no pregnancy happening. So these are the short-term or the problems during the reproductive life. Okay, so what are the long-term health problems in these women? So they have problem with the insulin resistance. So because there is insulin resistance, there will be development of diabetes. Then there is high blood pressure in them. Then development of malignancy or cancer, depression and mood swings. Sometimes even they may have snoring and daytime drowsiness, especially because of the body fat. So this obesity leads to lot of problem in these women, including psychological problems. So how do we reduce, how to tackle these problems? Okay, the short-term problems, what I told you, that is mainly acne, hirsutism, menstrual abnormality and fertility problems need to be handled. That means you need to report to the doctor if you have any of these problems, because menstruation has to happen at least in a year about 3 to 4 times. If the menstruation do not happen, it need not be every month. A woman need not bleed every month, but she should bleed at least 3 to 4 times in a year. So that is our aim, okay, when we are treating. Second thing is hirsutism, there are medications for that. And otherwise, it needs to be, you have to go for cosmetic, removal of these hairs. And the other is infertility, wherein we give medications so that the woman ovulates and she becomes pregnant. So there is treatment for PCOS. Now, how to reduce the long-term health risk? So, we need to create awareness. So PCOS is not just a small problem or it's only in the younger women, but it can lead to problems later on in life, which actually can be prevented. See, there are certain things PCOS as such cannot be prevented. If somebody has to develop PCOS, they will develop. But you can actually control the problems which it can be leading to. So that is what is important for us. So the long-term health problems are as I mentioned, diabetes, development of diabetes or high blood pressure, development of cancer. So all these things are long-term problems. Now that can be controlled by healthy eating. I think Dr. Meenakshi will be telling you about this healthy eating. Then cutting down on amount of sugar and salt and caffeine, reduction in the alcohol consumption. And it is recommended that women drink less, because even this can lead to long-term problems. Regular eating habits, especially not skipping the breakfast, exercising regularly. Okay, so that the BMI is maintained well between 19 and 25. BMI is body mass index. Anybody can calculate their own BMI by just checking the weight and height, and you get online a lot of formula. A lot of sites are there, but you can just put in. It is just weight divided by height in meter square. So you can calculate the BMI, and the normal BMI is anywhere between 19 and 25. More than 25, we call it as pre-obese or pre-overweight. More than 30 is obese. Okay, 30, more than 35 is severely obese, and more than 40 is very severe. So this is the normal BMI. So we need to, as long as the BMI is on the normal side, it is better. So there should be a healthy routine or healthy practice regarding the eating and exercise should be there. So it should not be, it should go on for long. It should not be for a short time, because short time is not worthwhile. It has to be maintained for a long period so that the weight is maintained. So it is very important that and the first and the foremost thing that we advise as doctors for these women who are suffering with PCOS is to lose weight. Okay, so that is the first thing that we tell. Even when they come with any kind of problem, the first thing we say is we send to dietitian, we send to the physiotherapist, we ask them to advise on these things so that the weight is reduced. So even about 5% reduction in the weight can significantly affect the PCO problem, and many women by reducing just 1 or 2 kgs also start ovulating and their menstruation becomes regular. So these are the benefits of losing weight: lowering the risk of insulin resistance and developing diabetes, lowering risk of heart problem and cancer of the uterus, more regular periods and increased chance of becoming pregnant, reduction in acne and decreased hair growth over the time, and also improved mood and of course self-esteem as they become, on the thinner side. Then it is very important that these women have a regular checks, especially for diabetes. You have to get the blood sugars checked if they're suffering from PCOS, because there is increased risk. Even if they have lost weight, there can be possibility that they develop diabetes very early. And even in pregnancy, they have high chances of developing diabetes. Then also the uterine cancer, especially if they don't have periods often. So if they have irregular periods, there is high risk that they develop an endometrial CA or uterine cancer. So that needs to be checked, and we need to at least visit the gynecologist after the age of 40. Then high blood pressure and cholesterol also can be controlled, and depression and psychological problems can be controlled. So is there a cure? So what is the answer? Is there a cure? The good thing is, well, it can be controlled, and there are many problems which can be prevented. And whatever the problem they are suffering from, there is treatment for that. But the bad thing is there's no permanent cure for PCOS. So that means it cannot be eliminated from the body. But well, all the problems which it is causing can be tackled effectively with effective medication and effective lifestyle modification. It can be brought into well under control. So the message is, most importantly, is if somebody has irregular cycles, to visit the hospital, visit the gynecologist. And the next thing is, most importantly, is to have a good or a healthy lifestyle so that the problems of long term can also be prevented. Along with the short term problems, even the long term problems can be brought into control, well under control. So thank you so much for your patient hearing.
Thank you, ma'am. Yes, thank you, ma'am, for a wonderful
session. I
hope session.
I have.
Yeah, it was really good. So I'll just pick few questions from the chat.
Yes.
So someone is asking, what is the ideal time to go for the hormonal test? Is it immediately after the period or hormonal test? Is it immediately
testing.
After? Yeah, hormonal testing. So is it immediately after the periods or is there any specific timing?
Okay. The generally, hormonal test is not required for the diagnosis of PCOS. Okay, so that is the first thing. And we usually, that is like a small, it depends on what is the age of the patient and with what problem they are coming from. Only then we decide on the hormonal test. So usually, if at all we want to do some hormonal test, that is done only in the women coming with infertility. Okay, when they don't, when they have not conceived and they want to try for conception, that is the time we start testing for the hormones. And it is usually done, say, it is done on second day of the menstruation only. Okay, no other day that we do this test, that is usually follicular stimulating hormone and luteinizing hormone. So this is done only on day two of the menstrual cycle. So usually if they don't have periods, we have to make them bleed and then we give the blood test. But for the diagnosis, we usually don't do this FSH and LH unless they have, say, hirsutism. As I mentioned earlier, if they have excessive hair growth, then we start investigating. Because that PCOS is not the only reason for development of this excessive hair. There are so many other problems. So serious problems are also there. So we need to test at that time. Otherwise, no.
Okay, so is it possible that someone lose the weight also? It's not like only gaining, because someone is messaging me personally that I am losing weight in such cases.
Okay, PCOS generally don't lose weight, but there is, say, if you one among the, say, if you have 10 PCO patients, one or two among them are actually lean PCOS. That is what we call. So 90% of them are generally on the overweight side. But about 10% of the women do have problem and they are thin. So we call them as lean PCOS, where they, for us to tackle lean PCOS is very difficult. Whereas obese PCOS, we tell them to lose weight. So by losing weight, majority of the problems come down. But lean PCOS, on the other hand, is difficult for us to tackle. They need medication because there is no point losing weight. They are already thin. We have seen very thin patients also with PCOS.
Right. Okay. So next question, madam, it is, can PCOS be cured completely?
No.
No.
It cannot be cured, but the problems, whatever it is causing, can definitely be tackled.
So in case of, okay, if somebody is diagnosed with the polycystic ovaries, overweight, yeah. But not obese, no hirsutism, and bleed regularly every month. But the amount of bleeding is very less. Is it? Is this of any concern?
I didn't get you. Can you repeat again?
Yeah, somebody is writing. If somebody is diagnosed with polycystic ovaries,
yeah,
is overweight, but not not obese, and no other symptoms, bleeding regularly.
No problem.
But amount of bleeding is very less. Is it a concern?
No, usually there will be, it's not that every woman will have, like, it's not universal that they should bleed 3 days, 4 days, changing 3-4 pads per day is not universal. Some people will have less bleeding. As long as there is bleeding every month, then no need to worry. They should be bleeding. That's all. It is okay if they bleed less, there's no problem.
Okay. So,
Yeah,
ma'am, please go ahead.
No, and weight also, they said that they're not overweight, then it's okay, fine. No need to worry.
Okay.
PCO ovary doesn't mean anything. Just PCO ovary, no need to worry.
Okay. So 6 to 7 periods yearly are fine. No need to worry.
That is good. Good enough. We aim for 4 to 5. 6 to 7 is good enough.
Okay. So next question. Is there any relation between thyroid hormone or and PCOS, ma'am?
Yes, actually, it's an endocrine problem, like how diabetes is there, how thyroid is there, like that PCOS is also an endocrine disorder. So definitely all these endocrine disorders are interrelated. There is a possibility that these patients can also have increased risk for development of hypothyroidism.
Okay.
Yes.
So if anyone wants to ask questions, they can raise the hand and ask their questions, please. Mm-hmm. Two questions we can take now. Anyone? No, I don't think. Chitra?